policy model was humanical on the action futures equations on surfaces. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Boyan, for the invitation to talk here. This is a joint work with Michael Sonica, a former student of mine. And this is the title of my talk. It's about the diffusion problem. Diffusion equation have been around for quite some time. And what should I say? Usually when talking about a diffusion problem, immediately pops up in everybody's minds a diffusion equation, as you know it, with in a domain, in a Euclidean domain, with some boundary condition. The most popular boundary condition being Dirichlet, Norman, or Steklov boundary condition. Well, this talk here is about diffusion on a surface. And for me, the most interesting part is the surface without a border. Although we also address the problem in surface with a border, but then it becomes a generalization of Euclidean domains. Okay. It is not what I'm going to talk about, the problem I'm going to address. It's not a hard problem to solve. Not at all hard to solve. Yet, I think it's a basic problem to be addressed, to be asked in mathematical physics. And the problem is this, as I guess most people here know, is a semilinear diffusion equation. This term here, let's agree to call this term reaction term, which is easy to say. Actually, for a scalar equation, it is a source or a sink. But we're gonna, let's agree to call it reaction term. So we have this diffusion equation, which can model the evolution in time of a population on a surface. Whenever I say surface, otherwise said, I mean a surface without border. So it could model the evolution of a population on the surface, or, as the most popular, heat equation. If you think of it as the heat equation, as it stands, this equation, we have to suppose that the surface is thermically isolated from inside and from outside for the heat equation. So whatever source or sink of heat is coming from within the surface. Okay, so let's ask the following question. Suppose you have this diffusion, semilinear diffusion equation, which governs evolution, the diffusion of something in a surface. Since we don't have the Laplacian here, we have this operator, A of x is called diffusivity. Diffusivity. The diffusivity here, whenever you deduce the equation, the diffusion equation, depends on the material the surface is made of. So we are going to be interested in the case that the diffusivity is not constant. So if the diffusivity is not constant, that amounts to say that the material the surface made of is not homogeneous. Most of the problems dealing with diffusion treats the case of a constant diffusivity. But it's a natural question ask, of course, not all. You could have a diffusion in a surface whose material is not homogeneous, of course. And then the question pops up. How? Okay, well, let me go back a little bit, say, but okay, the diffusivity depends on the material the surface made of. And what is going to be interesting here is to find the mechanism of interaction between the diffusivity A, it depends on the material, and the geometry of the surface, which give rise to existence, and sometime we're going to address the question of non-existence as well, of non-constant, stable, stationary solution. Why non-constant? Because the constant one are the trivial solution. Each root, constant root of f, f is a real function, any root of f is a trivial solution, it's a constant solution of this equation. So we're primarily interested in non-constant stationary solution. Stationary because for those equations, from the point of view of dynamic system, if you know the stability of the stationary solution, you know all, most of the time you know the whole dynamics of the equation. And any equation, no matter where we start, evolves to an equilibrium solution. So that's the importance of a stable stationary solution. And it's stable because it's stable, if you're interested from the physical point of view, they are the only persistent solution. Ultimately, those are the only solution that will exist. So we're going to be interested in non-constant, stable, stationary solution, which is in the literature is called pattern. Pattern comes from not a scalar diffusion equation. It comes from a system. Where comes the term reaction diffusion? Pattern because, well, in biomathematics, they label this solution as patterns. Okay, that said, let's move on. One question. If I'm going to address the non-constant diffusivity problem, how about the constant diffusivity problem in the same scenario? Okay. If diffusivity is constant, then we have a rigidity. A result about existence of patterns. If the diffusivity is constant, and you can even address the case of M is a Riemannian manifold without boundary, with no negative rich curvature, then that equation has no pattern. In this situation, the only solution, stable stationary solution, are the constant ones, the trivial ones. So, no big deal. No big deal. And that was proved by myself and Casasola in 2010. And I should say that 2 years later, these people here, Catherine Bandopoulos and Tizek, came up with a much simpler proof based on this Bochner-Watson-Bock identity. This identity here, H iteration, which stands for the rich curvature, is a much simpler proof. Okay. So before we move on, let's say a few words about the background of this problem. Not in surface. For surf, I mean, I never saw any result on surf. That's because we address it. But going back on time, a couple of people starts address the same equation, but in an interval with a normal boundary condition. So if it is the heat equation, the ends of the interval of the bar are thermically isolated. In 1983, Jack Hale and Michel Chipeau, they proved that if the second derivative of the diffusive function is negative, the function is concave. There is no pattern. The proof is just a long computation. You find a candidate and plug in the Brillouin coefficient and use the variational characterization of the eigenvalues. Actually, some months earlier, Ian Aguirre proof gave a somehow more general condition requiring that the second derivative of the root square of the diffusivity be negative. That much for an interval. It's interesting, this is still an open problem to find, to say, for instance, to find out if in a convex domain, for a convex, has no pattern. This is still an open problem. It has been an open problem for 30 years. Although that doesn't tell much, right? A problem could be one century older, and not because it's difficult, but simply because maybe nobody tried to solve it, right? But not the case. Many people tried to solve it, but it happens that the arguments used for one dimension does work. One have to, I don't know, find any other argument. So this is that what was known for an interval, for non-existence. Existence of diffusivity function of step type to give rise to pattern was established by the same, around the same time by Jack Hale and Rocha from Portugal, in Hale and Giorgio Fusco, also in an interval. Was always based in phase plane study using polar coordinates, those kind of things. And the step function, the diffusivities, they use constant, piecewise constant function. Those results about existence were generalized later on by myself for two-dimensional domain using gamma conversions, and later on to any dimensional domain just to use the arguments of the calculus of variation. It turns out that the last result here for a domain in Rn if you have, say, any surface here around which the diffusivity has a minimum around the surface, then that's enough to assure the existence of pattern. So it's a very general result. If the diffusivity is small around a surface, you have a pattern. The idea is that the diffusivity being small hinders the diffusion. So if you start close it to a stable state here, another stable state there, somehow you can connect these two states along a neighborhood on which the diffusivity is small, and they still keep that a stable solution. Okay, let's go back to our problem. So, the scenario is going to be the simplest possible. Why is that? Because we wanted to capture that mechanism of interaction between the diffusivity and the geometry as simple as possible, the most simple, if possible, mechanism. So let's start with a parametrized curve and consider the surface generated by this curve. As it varies, we're going to fix this interval from 0 to L, and theta, the angular variable, varies from 0 to pi, of course. This function here, psi, is underlined because it's in red, because it's going to play an essential role in the rest of the talk. It's going to reflect the geometry of the surface. It is, of course, the distance from the zx to the surface. Psi is a positive function, vanish on the end of the interval because the surface has no border. And smoothness also implies that the derivative vanishes here. If you have an M-dimensional Riemannian manifold with this metric, with a local metric, in local coordinates expressed like this one, and you have a vector field x, it is known that the divergence of this vector field regarding this local metric is this is expression here. Of course, the summation in I is also omitted. And for a surface of revolution, if you take the coordinates x1 s and x2 theta, then it becomes it is a Riemannian manifold with this metric. And at this point, since, as I said before, I'm going to keep the scenario as simple as possible, we suppose that the diffusion function does not depend on the angular variable. Depends on the parameter s. So in this case, that operator reduced to this simpler operator here. And our equation writes, we finally have this equation. This should be followed with some boundary condition, but boundary condition plays no role here, because in the angular variable, it is the periodic boundary condition, and you say you have a Neumann because of the smoothness of the surface and the solution. Boundary in the S variable. This lemma here is standard, and it says that every stationary solution to this equation, which depends on the angular variable, is unstable. The proof is very simple: to take a solution, take the derivative, and show that that's it's classical by now. Is an eigenfunction corresponding to zero eigenvalue. It does not change sign, so it cannot be the first eigenvalue. So use the variational characterization of eigenvalues to show that it is unstable. So that makes our life easier, because then we can suppose that every stationary solution does not depend on the variable, on the angular variable. And the first result regarding non-existence is this one. So suppose the surface revolution is smooth, without border. Let capital K be its Gaussian curvature, capital K sub G its geodesic curvature, and the reaction term any C1 function. If the Gaussian curvature plus the square of the geodesic curvature is bigger or equal than this expression, then any non-constant stationary solution to that equation is unstable. This is still not sharp. It's not. It comes because you see this term here. Here it depends only the geometry of the surface. This term here depends on the geometry and the diffusivity. The diffusivity function does not show up here. But this is somehow awkward to work with to find the simple examples. And it does not depend on F, this sufficient condition. Does not depend on F. But we're going to show some examples where we can expect no pattern. For instance, the obvious example is to start with is the surface revolution being the unit sphere. If you take so this diffusion problem, a unit sphere, and the diffusivity to be the square sine of S plus 1, then there are no patterns, for instance. This is one example, a simple one, just to make things simple. That diffusivity function looks like it has just one bump, and it's smooth and flat in the ends. However, if you take this diffusivity function here, which is made with the same function but with another reparametrized here, the condition 5, which that condition is less picture, fails. So there might exist a reaction term so that the problem has pattern for this diffusivity function here. For this one, it has no pattern because of the theorem. This diffusivity function does not satisfy that equation. It can be, it's an easy computation. So there could be an F such that solution has a pattern for this diffusivity function. And we're going to show, we can show that's the case. What's the big difference, what's the more essential difference between this subfunction and this one? This one has just one bump, and the second one has two. And if you have this diffusivity on a sphere, what the diffusivity does is to spread, say, the diffusion substance, to spread it. So it does not help to concentrate then and separate the parts of the domain, of the sphere. And this one is different. It has a minimum here. Inside the sphere, we make difficult for the diffusion, separate the states to join together. So for this diffusivity function, here we prove the following result. Unfortunately, we could not prove it for surface without boundary. So for the time being, we took a surface with the boundary. So suppose you have a surface with a boundary now, and normal boundary condition, conormal derivative here. It could be this surface here, for instance. The theorem goes as follows. If you take this surface of a surface revolution with the border, if for some S in this interval, that former inequality, differential inequality, fails to exist and just one single point, and we needed this technical condition that the diffusivity is increasing up to this point and decreasing beyond this point, then we show that there exists a reaction term F such that our equation has a non-constant, stable, stationary solution. The proof of this theorem is an article, a paper by itself, it's a long proof. So I'm not going to talk about it. I should say, though, that's largely stemmed from a result, an early result from 1980. I guess that paper from Ian Aguido, we mentioned that. It's inspired of an argument he uses there. For an example like this, we can take this simple diffusivity function, the surface for revolution with the border, along with normal boundary condition in the surface, on the border. And for this case, and for this diffusivity, we can prove that there is a reaction term that the problem has a pattern. Okay, but let's move to the what I should say is the most important part of this talk, which concerns the existence of a pattern. To that end, let's introduce in the equation a small parameter here, and write our diffusion equation like this. Some care should be taken about the condition, the ends of the north pole and south pole of the surface revolution. But that's work well. And concerning the existence, we're going to take now f a bistable function, the reaction bistable is a function like this. F, so it has two constant stable states, alpha and beta. Let's say that the equilibrium solution of this equation are, as always, this is a variational approach, critical points of this functional. So let's stick with this functional here. Capital F, as always, is potential, the primitive of little f. The psi function, which is given the geometry, appears here and here. Here we have the square, as always, of the derivative, and the diffusivity here. Gamma conversions sometimes turns out to be very useful to solve some kind of problem. Somehow, keeps the simplest geometry possible. And this is the case for this problem. So let's agree to call this energy functionals. And since not many people are familiar with the definition of gamma convergence, we give it here. If you have a family of our functional, we say that the gamma convergence f goes to zero to another functional capital E naught. If for any family of L1 function, the convergence in L1 topology to U implies that limit inf of the function evaluated in this family is bigger or equal than the candidate to be the gamma limit evaluated at U. U here, U epsilon here. For any family. And also, for any U, for any function L1, you can construct a family of omega epsilon, which converges to U in L1 topology, and such that the candidate to be the gamma conversion limit evaluated at U is bigger or equal to the limit sup here, as opposed to here, which is limit inf, here's limit sup, of the original function computed at the omega epsilon. This is the definition of gamma convergence. We're going to use full strength result due to Kohn and Sternberg, which relates local minimizers of the original energy functional to local minimizer of the gamma limit. Their theorem says the following. Suppose that the family of functional gamma converges to capital E naught. And that any family which has bounded the energy is compact in L1. That in part answers the question because we're going to work in the gamma limit and BV functions, the space of functional boundary variation, because BV function is compact immersed in L1. And suppose also that there exists an isolated L1 local minimizer V0 of the gamma limit E0. This is what you have to show here in order to accomplish what you want. The main question, this minimum has to be isolated. Okay, so under this condition, we can assure the existence of a family V epsilon. It's a local L1 topology minimizer. This is wrong here. This should be the capital E, not capital lambda. And it gives you also, it says something about the geometric structure of this solution because they said it converges in L1 topology to V0, V0 being the isolated minimizer of the gamma limit. Okay, we're going to use this result. This theorem, so that family of energy functional gamma converges to this functional here. The limit in the gamma converged sense of this functional is this one here, when epsilon goes to zero. See how beautiful the geometry and the diffusivity function comes together here in a very simple way. You just multiply the psi, which is the distance from the zx to the surface, times the root square of the diffusivity function. This measure here is just the measure of total variation. And you see how this functional depends on U. It evaluates on U, and U comes here. So it depends on U through the measure. So based on that theorem by Sternberg and Kohn, all you have to do is find a local minimizer for this function. Right? Here BV, this interval here is 0L, and alpha and beta are the roots of the action term. So we're going to work in the space of BV function, boundary variation function, which are piecewise constant and takes on only two values, alpha and beta. So this lemma here is crucial to our proof. Suppose you have a local isolation. This is now the integrand with respect to that measure, the boundary variation measure. It's a real function from the interval. So let's suppose it has an isolated minimizer at some point S naught. If this is so, then this function here, U naught, which is alpha in this interval and beta in the remainder of the interval, the rest of the interval, is a local isolated minimizer of the gamma limited function.
Well, time goes by so fast.
Let me give you an idea how to prove it. Since we suppose that the S naught is a local minimum of this solution, that means this function S naught is less than this one for any point in this neighborhood. So the whole thing now is to find a convenient neighborhood in the L1 topology, in the space of BV function, piecewise constant BV function, and show that this U0 is a minimum of the functional in that small neighborhood. So the candidate to be the wages of that neighborhood is delta naught, which is the neighborhood of this one in S, times absolute value of the difference between alpha and beta, which is the roots of F divided by 2. And so, and let's take any function in this neighborhood with this radio here. We claim that if U is in L1, then, of course, to show it's a minimum, U naught is a minimum, we have to show this inequality, strict inequality. If U is not B in BV, we define the functional by penalization, the inequality holds trivially. So let's call capital S sub U the set of the jump set of U. Since U is piecewise constant, we call S of U all the points where U jumps from alpha to beta. So if SU enter this neighborhood, is empty, then there are only two possibilities. U is constant equal alpha, or U is constant equal beta. In both cases, the Anisi computations show that those solutions are not in this delta L1 neighborhood. So they are not in the neighborhood. They not come into play. It remains the possibility that the jump set enter that neighborhood is not empty. And if that's so, we take S1 in this interception. So the S1 is another jump set of the competing function U. All you have to show for this function is that U naught U is strictly bigger than U naught U naught. This is by definition, what you came up with, the gamma limit. And it turns out that this measure here, which is total boundary area measure, by a result I get a feather, is nothing but except for a multiplicative constant, which is this constant here. In this case, is the Hausdorff counting measure. Hausdorff counting measure. So this integral here with this measure is equivalent to the integral on the jump set of U of this integral here, integrand here, which is psi. And this is nothing but the integrand evaluated for the those points of the jump discontinuity of U. So this is this summation here over the point of discontinuity, jump points of U. Of course, this is positive, so it's bigger or equal than the function evaluated in S1. But since S0 is a minimum, this is strictly bigger than this amount here, which is just the U0 evaluated at U0, E0 and U0. There is still another possibility. If that point, jump point, coincides with the S0. If that's the case, one possibility is U being U0, but this case is not allowed. Another possibility is that we flip the values of alpha and beta. We flip the values, but if that's the case, this function also is not in the neighborhood. We found a convenient neighborhood in L1 topology. There is still another possibility. If there is another point in jump set different of S1, then we trivially prove that strict inequality also. And wrapping up all these results, what you come up with is this theorem. So if F is a before the reaction theorem, is of this type here, is bistable. And if this function here, which This so is the mechanism interaction between the geometry of the surface and the diffusivity through its root square of diffusivity. If it has a isolated local minimum at some point, then you can assure that there exists a family of a stable, stationary solution, equilibrium solution, to this equation on surface revolution. Gamma convergence is nice because it also says that this family of stable stationary solution converges in L1 topology to U0. U0, you know what it is. It's alpha up to this minimum point here, S0, and beta in the rest of the interval. So if you have, for instance, a sphere, you have a stable pattern. If it, this solution here, I'll show some example. For instance, let's take the M to be the unity sphere, and this diffusivity function here. This function, then, with this diffusivity function, this function has an isolated local minimum at pi over 2. Then there is a family of a constant stable solution satisfying convergence to this function here. So in this case, you have this sphere, and those patterns, you can say that in the north hemisphere is closer to alpha, say, and south hemisphere closer to beta. So you know some qualitative properties of the pattern. And okay, to finish it, just as a byproduct of this theorem, if the diffusivity is constant, then you can minimize it only psi, which is the distance. But minimize psi amounts to minimize this distance here. So in this particular case, for constant diffusivity, if you take a surface revolution like this, which is a minimum, has a minimum here, it's a neck, you get a pattern, stable stationary solution for this surface. It's approximately constant equal alpha here and beta here, above the neck and under the neck. And I appreciate your attention.
Thank you very much. Any questions?